Hello, folks, and welcome to the Vertigo Tea Party and Let's Try Maize. It's developed by Finish Line Games. It's available for Windows for $19.99. You can buy it on Steam, GOG, and the Humble Store. It has partial controller support, and I will be playing a free press copy that was provided to me in order to make this video. All relevant links will be in the description below the video. So let's go ahead and start a new game. I already have started playing. Yes, I'm okay with overwriting the my save file. I actually have beaten the game. Not in particular, just because it's short. It is relatively short. It's about a 4 to 5 hour game. It took me roughly about 4 hours to beat it. But it wasn't just because it was short, but because the pacing was so well done, or at least I felt the pacing was so well done, especially in a puzzle game. It was interesting enough for me to actually finish it until the point I was like, oh, I've beat the game now. Or I kind of got to the point where I knew I was close and I just wanted to beat it because I was enjoying it and I wanted to see how it was going to turn out. So I'm going to try to avoid spoilers. That's when we're going to start at the very beginning. Some of the stuff is already known. There's also no audio in the beginning, which is really odd. Like, it's just very, very quiet. Here in a second, we'll actually start getting some sounds, some music going on, etc. So, if you know anything about this game, and this game came out a while back, I've actually looked very, very behind on my Let's Try. Sorry about that. But the premise here without... I don't consider this a spoiler because this is like the most well-known thing about this game, is it's an adventure game that involves sentient corn. So we will be talking to corn eventually. And that's one of the big things that this is circling around. As you can imagine, the game does not take itself too seriously. There's a lot of comical writing, funny dialogues, things like that. So the game doesn't take itself too seriously, and it ends up working out really well. And it's kind of funny because especially early on, maybe not so much later, there is definitely a creepy vibe to it at the beginning when you're by yourself for quite a while. It does lighten up a lot later, but it's definitely not what I would consider to be a scary game at all. So controls are very basic. I'm using keyboard and mouse, WASD to move, left click interacts with things. And we see we need three things here. Looks like a hand, some kind of DNA looking thing, and a circular slot. Probably requiring some kind of object, which itself is circular, if I just had to guess. But you can run with shift. The pause menu, as you can see, you can open up with escape or P. Funny enough, the pause menu does not actually pause the game. It brings up your menu, but things still happen. It doesn't really end up mattering though, because, and as you can see, Q does nothing, or does it? I pressed it a bunch. I feel like it actually is doing something, even though the game may be lying to you. Don't trust anything you read. Especially when sentient corn is involved. Now, this is a mechanic they use quite frequently. And some adventure game purists are not going to like this. Myself, where I enjoy adventure games, but sometimes get bogged down if I can't solve the puzzle and I'll get frustrated, either look it up or quit the game and maybe never come back. But the idea here is that they will block off areas that are irrelevant for the time, until you have progressed enough or picked up enough items or solved the correct puzzles for those paths to open up. In fact, they'll even use that so that you can't backtrack into areas that you were at before if they are not relevant. And I'll talk about that in a little bit. Just so those of you who are kind of throwing up red flags, I want to talk about that a little bit further before you give up on the game. So you left click to pick up an item. English muffin. Oh, and the little corn took the crates away, and now we can go through there. And the game will tell you when that happens. It'll say, as you saw, that like a path has opened up for you. So we'll talk about this now, the examining items. Press E. This just examines whatever item you have in your hand. So this says, Howard is a granite. This muffin is most definitely nowhere near fit for consumption, despite how much you try. All you've done is given yourself a headache. Again, most of the descriptions are like kind of smarmy, smart-assy type comments. So we can also see where things are by the markings here, and you can see, oh, nope, I can't go there. So let's actually talk about the blocking off, because again, I feel like this is something some adventure game fans are going to hate, but some people are going to really like. It's to me personally, I like it a lot because I get frustrated if I spend a lot of time backtracking, and especially when it ends up being not related, or if I end up going to an area that I'm not supposed to go to yet, that doesn't have anything relevant to me. Oh, we know that we can't do anything there yet because when you click it, it beeps at us, and the little finger pointing down indicates that something is there. And it says locked door, so I would just imagine that it's probably a key we need to find. So let's go ahead and look around for that. A garage door. I don't think that's a garage. Maybe you should not park your car down there. If you do see one of those, you are probably not going to be getting it out. Let's check in the chicken coop. There's also a folio. You can open that by pressing space. Oh wow, it actually has all my stuff from the folio. Interesting. Oh, that's right. I think earlier it said that you keep your folio regardless. The folio is entirely optional. This is just flavor or story type items that you can pick up. As you can see, I got 65 of 75. Again, you do not need them to progress, but it's got a lot of funny things. Many of them have nothing to do with the story, but some of them will give you a little bit more info about the world, the characters, what led up to the points that they get, basically how they get to where they are now, which I like. I like things like that. Again, not necessary, but gives you a reason to want to look around. And it's not as, shall we say, worthless as things that are. Again, as you can see, they've got quite a bit of like amusing commentary here and there to mix things up. But I forgot what I was even saying about the other thing. Oh, there's a rusty nail jammed into a wall. Obviously, I want that, but I can't grab it. If only there was a way to get that. I guess I'll have to remember to come back later and check it out. But now we have this key. Let's go see if it opens the house. Believe I'm going the right way. Early on, you can get quite lost in this corner. It's not too bad. It is fairly winding, though, and I did a little bit of backtracking early on. I kind of feel like the idea of blocking off areas that you've been to, but they don't want you to backtrack to because there's nothing of value there, might have come up a little bit later in development. Because very early on, you can backtrack quite a bit into areas that are not useful to you at all. And I spent a lot of time, well, not a lot, a decent amount of time kind of backtracking in the maze, because of that. Which, again, not a complaint per se, just kind of making that statement. And, you know, you can shift endlessly, you don't have a stamina bar, anything like that, so you don't have to worry about running out of stamina. So let's check in the kitchen here. And those rooms are dark on purpose because the house has no power. A sausage grinder. Something is jammed inside. Again, you can click it. Nothing happens. Fruit crate. You can see it's in our inventory. I can change items with the mouse wheel. I can also press number keys. I can also put it away if it's in the way, which it sometimes is. Got a bathtub plug. And because I know what's going on, I'm going to put it in the sink. Sink is now plugged. And you cannot unplug it. What do we got in the medicine cabinet? Nail clippers. Now, here's one thing I'm not crazy about. So let's examine these nail clippers. It says, vigilant as you are when it comes to personal hygiene, the only two things these clippers will do for you are grip something lodged in a wall and give you a 100% tetanus guarantee. That's it. So some of the item descriptions are a little bit overly obvious in that either the hints are too strong that they give you, or they will just sometimes flat out say how to use the item to solve a puzzle. I don't like that, because at that point, when you're telling me how to use the item, at that point you're basically telling me how to play the game, right? You're saying this is what you do, this is how to solve the puzzle. And at that point, I might as well just watch a video to get the idea of the story. I want to actually figure this stuff out on my own. And they don't do that all the time, but it happens a little bit more than I would like. And I do feel like it probably happens less later on. And maybe early on, they're just kind of trying to point you in the right direction of what to use things with. But yeah, it is definitely something I'm not crazy about. So you see there, they were trying to teach you about Crouch, and you know, along the way, they, you know, pointed out a like button that opens up the stairs here. That kind of thing I don't have a problem with. Again, they're trying to teach you the controls, which there are minimal controls. You don't have to worry about a lot of controls in this game. So that's fine. But again, I wish they would have toned back a little bit on being overly forward with the descriptions on the items that you pick up. So a fuse box, which is missing a fuse. Basement is very, very dark here, or the cellar. I guess it's technically a cellar. I don't really know what the difference between, what is the difference between a cellar and a basement? If anybody knows, let me know in the comments. So that just opens the cellar doors that we saw before. Let's check the upstairs. And I'm going to show you another example of the overly descriptive items. And like I said, despite that, I've very much enjoyed this game so far. I've liked it a lot. And to the point, like I say, I beat the game. And that almost never happens with Let's Tries. Got a bobby pin. You can look at that. Extremely useful for picking a lock, but you mistakenly thought it was a pencil and wrote a very detailed account of your day up to that point, and didn't notice there was no ink until a few hours later. So that's one funny reoccurring theme in the like the item descriptions, is it'll kind of talk about how you tried to figure out how to use an item. And a lot of times they're not, you know, not painting you in the best picture insofar as being a bright individual. Which I find interesting, since the item descriptions are written in such a way as they're done by a third person. So whenever an item needs to be placed, you'll see an outline of it. Again, a lot of adventure game purists might not be crazy about that, because again, it's basically telling you, even if I didn't have the crate, right? You can look at it and go, oh, that's obviously a crate. I can see the handles, the distinctive rectangular shape. And we can place that here. But when we click the wobbly dresser, which it said wobbly dresser before I put the crate, by the way, we can't do anything with it. So obviously we need more. And of course you can always do the adventure game trope of selecting every item and trying to interact with the object and see if it works. Speaking of, one thing about adventure games, especially adventure games of yore, where a lot of them were very obtuse, like you're using the gum with the cat and the string to obtain the key that's fell down the sewer grate. Like, they're just very nonsensical. This game, for the most part, within the realm of this game, it makes sense. I don't think anything has been so weird that I was like, oh, I would have never suggested, or I never thought that this would have been the answer to this puzzle. So I do like that. But again, part of that could be because the item descriptions are so very specific in many cases. But even without that, again, most of the time, you're probably going to figure out the puzzles without too much problem. The good thing about that I found with this game, and again, one of the reasons I ended up beating it, was the flow felt very, very good. And you can imagine where I'm going here, by the way. So we're going to use our nail clippers with the rusty nail jammed in a wall. And as, again, is standard with adventure games, whenever you use an item and it's no longer useful, it removes it from your inventory. Now, why items are colored different things, I'm not quite sure. I don't know if that's just random or what, but let's see if we read the rusty nail's description. Rusty nail, for some reason, the first thing that pops in your head is that it would be a good conductor of electricity, possibly as a fuse. You are very strange. So again, it just flat out tells you the answer. And again, I don't think it's as blatant later on with the descriptions, but it still gives a little bit more info than I would have preferred. But let's use the rusty nail as a fuse. By the way, please do not do this at home, boys and girls. Probably not gonna end well. I'm not a electrologist, but I'm gonna guess that will not go well for you. So let's head on up here. Still can't figure out how to get that out of there. Well, let's go upstairs. Now, if we could only push over this dresser, it's probably very heavy despite being wobbly. Let's try we got a new item, the shovel handle, and sure enough, we use that to get a little leverage, push it over, and find this new room. See what we can find. I also, one thing I do like is the item highlights. Because one thing that vexed many old adventure games was pixel hunting, trying to find that one item amongst the 20 others that were just scenery that you can actually interact with. This game, not a problem. On occasion, I've run into issues where, like, I couldn't see the item's outline because of stuff around it. Like, so it was like white on white, for example. But that didn't happen like enough for it to be a major complaint. And again, it's already highlighted, so I'm not going to complain that, well, you know, the highlight's just not obvious enough. So I think that's everything up here. But again, the other thing I like about the highlighting, you're not looking everywhere if you get stuck. You're not like, okay, is there a single book here I can click on? Again, pixel hunting. Don't really have that problem in this game, which I enjoy. Most of your time is spent either exploring, finding the items, and then figuring out how to use said items and moving on to the next area. So I think we've checked everything up here. Let's see, what items do we have? I'm trying to recall where we must be. So I think we can't go to the barn yet, as you can see from the bright orange boxes. I also like that they made them bright orange, so it's very, very easy to see. We're not going to play too much further because, again, one of the main things of the adventure game is figuring out the puzzles all on your own. And if I just do them all for you, you won't learn nothing. Let's go. I'm drawing a blank here as to where to go next. I do believe there's one other area we can get to. That I also love that they put these signs up here because my memory is horrible, absolutely terrible. So it's basically given the maze-like nature, no pun intended, of this area. It's much appreciated that those things are there so that when I come back around, I can be like, oh yeah, I need to go to this other area. One minor complaint I have is the little dot in the middle here. Actually, I guess we really can't go anywhere else, can we? I swore there was one other area we could get to. But anyway, the other minor complaint I have is the little dot. You can't get rid of it. Oh, I remember now. I also missed this my first time through. But you can't hide this little white dot. It's a little distracting sometimes. Again, very minor complaint, but I wish you could hide that. And what's sad is the radio, I think, is supposed to be kind of a hint as to what you're supposed to do, but I completely miss it. So we're going to do this. Open the CD player. Picked up a CD. A new path is open to you, the barn and silo. So now we can see, oh, those boxes have mysteriously moved. So we'll go down here. We'll do a little bit more. But I think you get the idea of the flow. The flow, again, it very, very much like we've seen, you're allowed to an area. It's fairly limited. You find the objects there. You figure out how to use those objects for puzzles. And it's not entirely self-contained, right? It's not like every item you find in that one area is going to be specifically used in that area. I do like that it makes it a little bit more natural that that's not the case. But again, some of the hardcore adventure game folks might not be crazy about it. As far as like aesthetics and whatnot, I love the way the game looks. It looks great. It runs well. I'm pretty much, you might see some frame rate dips on YouTube, but that's just due to me recording. While I was playing, I didn't have any frame rate issues. Kept a pretty steady 60 FPS the whole time. And I have everything on Epic, which we will be looking at the options that are available to you here in just a little bit. Good, bad, and question marks. I still, even after knowing, you know, all the things that have happened, I'm not quite sure what that's in reference to. We did find a broom, always very, very handy. Place to work out, something to look, trying to become like that. Gotta have, if you really want to get the ladies, you got to have the, oh my gosh, what's it called? Mullet. Am I right, ladies? You know it. You know you go crazy for mullets. Let's see. And also keep in mind, there's more of those memento things. These folio items are missing just because I've done this before, right? I've already grabbed them. So it does save that, even with a new game, which is interesting, but it allows you to, you know, come back and try to find the rest of the items. There's also a chapter select as well. But the problem with the chapter select that I don't like is that, as you saw at the beginning, when I made a new game, it wiped all my existing data. I don't know why I try to say that all fancy-like. but it does wipe your pre-existing data. So keep that in mind. So if you start folio hunting, you probably want to start the later chapters. But I guess if you beat the game anyway, it doesn't matter at that point. So fair dues. So here's a silo with a lock. Gee, if only I had some way to open the padlock. All right, let's head on in. Apparently this was also a relaxation point for them. What do we have here? A pile of corn kernels. If only I could move those away. I can't use my hand. That's unacceptable. Oh, and what do you know? Get some needle nose pliers. I don't think there's anything else in here. So, I wonder, with these needle nose pliers, what could we do? It's almost like we could use them to pull something out. You saw something in that sausage grinder that could be removed with these pliers. You know this because you spent an uncomfortable amount of time trying to pull it out with your hands, making no progress whatsoever. So, again, blatantly tells you how to solve that puzzle. Let's go ahead and head back and do that, and we'll probably wrap up at that point, because I don't want to show you too much more. I think you understand kind of the flow of the game. And to emphasize one more time, and the final time, I won't mention it again, but despite it being overly obvious with the puzzle answers at the beginning, it's still more giving of information later on than I would have preferred, but it's usually not quite as blatant as it is early, where it literally just flat out told us, look, just go use these needle nose pliers, pull the thing out, and then you can progress. Pulled warp key fob out of sausage grinder. Not an ideal place for it. It's easy to find, I guess. Probably easy to break as well. So let's take a look at the key fob. The warped key fob would be useful if you could flatten it back to its original shape. At first, you tried to do this by staring very hard. It didn't work. So you set out to find a tool that will do the job much better. Almost like a hammer. This is one of those weird places in the game where it's like, okay, I know I need to use the mallet with the key fob, but how do I do that? I'll have them both in my inventory. When that happens in this game, which is pretty rare, you have to find a specific area to do it. And that's one reason you want to take special note anytime you see like an outline of something to place down. So early, and I should have mentioned this earlier, and we saw it before with the fruit boxes, but when you see an outline like this, you'll definitely want to note mentally where you remembered seeing this. Because one thing that kind of tripped me up was I remembered seeing this, but I couldn't remember where I found it. So I had to do a little bit of looking around to recall where that is. So make sure to note it. But anyway, so we switch to our warped key fob, throw it on there, and then bash it with a hammer. I love any puzzle that I can solve by bashing it. Even though some good pounding noises would have been great there. I'm going to grab this, and we're done. So we're going to stop it there. Let me just double check my notes here over anything I wanted to cover. We're going to go over the options here in just a second. But, and later on, and again, many of you probably know this if you've watched much media on the game, but later on you get a companion of sorts. And I feel that for the most part, he was amusing, but some of the dialogue options, or not options, but the dialogue he spoke was a little bit repetitive. And again, I'm trying to be as vague as possible. And I think they did that on purpose a little bit, but it did get a little grating after a while. Not the nature of the dialogue, just like using the exact same words over and over again. It wasn't awful. It was just kind of like, I wish they would have mixed it up a little bit. But everything else, like I said, the pacing, I love the pacing of this game. It's helped a lot by how they help you along with the puzzles, with the description of the items, with the item highlights, and by the way they like block you off into an area. Because again, even in this farm area where you stay quite a bit, as you progress, certain areas that you were able to get to earlier will get blocked off. That way you know, oh, I don't need to backtrack all the way here to go find an item that maybe I missed, or something new opened up, something along those lines. It does a good job of keeping you focused on the area that you need to be focused in. And again, I think overall that helps the flow of the game. Again, hardcore adventure fans might be annoyed by that. Overall, I thought it was a positive in this game. I thought it was done well enough that I didn't feel too much like I was having my hand held. It was a little bit there, but it wasn't a major negative. Overall, though, I really enjoy this game quite a bit. I like the dialogue. I like the way it looks. I love the feel. I like the backstory going on with the things that are happening. And I was very interested to see it through to the end to find out what exactly happened by, well, the end. So let's go ahead and look at the options, and then we'll draw to a close. Standard stuff here, resolution. You can switch between full screen windowed and windowed, VSync on and off. You can just adjust the gamma. The settings here are very obvious. I'm not going to change these because they change as you go through them, and that might cause an issue with the recording. But you can change like the overall quality. You can specifically change it for shadows, anti-aliasing, textures, and post-processing if you're having some issues. But again, I've got a GTX 980 Ti, and I was able to keep it 60 frames a second with no problem. Audio, again, thank you for having the music and sound effects and ambience all separate. I hate when they throw them together, so it's really nice that they're split up like this. Let's see, the mouse, we can invert the mouse if you're one of those people. Change mouse sensitivity, mouse smoothing. Very minimal of gamepad controls here. You can change the sensitivity. I didn't mess with the gamepad at all, but I could see how this game would have no problem playing with the gamepad. There's nothing too complicated that you would need to use mouse and keyboard. And it does have all the controls here in case you do forget what something does, which is nice. I appreciate, because sometimes I feel like games with simple controls don't do this, because they just assume, oh, okay, you'll remember everything. But, you know, if you put the game down for a couple weeks or even a week, or if you're me, more than a couple hours and come back to it, you might forget what they are. So it's nice when they do little things like that. But anyway, that was Maize. Again, very much like this game. I would say it might be a little bit pricey. $20 for a game that you're probably going to be in, depending on how hard you look to find all the folio items, anywhere from about 4 to 5 hours. So I feel like it's a little overpriced for that, but if it went on sale for 10 to even 15, I would say it was worth it. It was an enjoyable experience for me. I felt the pacing was great. I was constantly interested in the story. And like I said, I just overall had a good time with it. But thank you guys for watching. Again, make sure if you want to pick the game up, there are links in the description to Steam, the Humble Store, and GOG. But yeah, leave your comments in the comment section below. Let me know what you thought of this game. And if you are interested to see more games or more videos like this covering games you might not have heard of, make sure to subscribe. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you next time.